Hey guys, my name is David. Welcome to Fearless TV. We're so excited you've joined us today. I know this message is going to impact you in such a powerful way. If you've been watching our previous messages or even today, you're just positively impacted or really moved by this message, we encourage you to share it with a friend. Put it on your Facebook, your Instagram story. We want to get the word out about what God is doing through Fearless here in LA. Or if you're saying, hey, how do I further partner with the mission of what Fearless is doing, what God is really doing through our church in downtown LA, reaching these people who don't know Jesus, we have our Fearless Partnerships. It's basically just a group of people who are giving monthly, whether a part of our church or your state's away, and you're just saying, I want to sow into what God is doing. You can give monthly to the vision of Fearless. You can go to fearlessla.com, click on the giving link. There's a whole description in there. I encourage you, read about it, pray on it, and just be obedient to the voice of God as He speaks to you. Other than that, check out this amazing message from our pastor. We love you guys. We'll see you soon.
I want to read you something, Isaiah 61 and 61:1, and I really believe this is a word for us today. And I'm just going to read it over you, and it says this: "The Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim the good news." So this is not bad news. This is what? Good news to the poor. And this is not poor financially, this is poor in spirit. "He has sent me to build up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and a release from darkness." How many of you guys know darkness can be a prison? Someone said it's rough. "To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance for our God." And that's vengeance to fear. That's vengeance to anger. That's vengeance to the hurt and the abuse. "To comfort all those who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion. To bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, and the oil of joy instead of mourning, and the garment of praise instead of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for His display and His splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins, restore the places long devastated. They will renew the reunited cities and they that have been devastated for generations. Instead of shame, you will receive a double portion. Instead of disgrace, you will receive an inheritance. And so you will inherit a double portion in your land. And everlasting joy will be yours." Come on, whoever believes that in this room, who receives that for themselves, this is what I'm declaring over you, a prophetic word today from His Word today. And you can believe that, and you can walk out with it, or you can reject it and walk out without it. When Jesus walked this earth, He was the Word. And to those that believed, they received. To those that didn't, they walked out without Him. And so today, I don't know what you got to do to get yourself to believe this. I don't know what you got to shake off to get yourself to unite with this. But I'm uniting with this word over my life. Darkness is gone. Come on, the sovereignty of the risen Lord over my life. Come on. Will you grab your neighbor's hand? We're going to pray into this service over this family. And we're going to clean house today. Come on, somebody say, I'm cleaning house. Cleaning house, cleaning house. Jesus, we just thank You for today. And Lord, we begin a journey of cleaning house today. And Lord, we thank You, Father, for cleaning day. We thank You, God, that today You have not left us alone. You've sent the Holy Spirit and Your word and Your truth over us, God. And we We pull up the shutters, we open the windows, and we bring the light into this house. And Lord, we say yes to the good news of the gospel of Jesus, that you have not just heaven waiting for us, but you want to do something in our land, in the territory you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody that believes that, come on, shout amen in this house. Praise God. Praise God. Why don't you give your neighbor a high five, a pounded, a bear hug, a holy kiss, whichever you end at, that's up to you. Someone ended just with a pounded. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God Almighty. Well, hey, I want to just let you know we're going to be jumping over to the book of 2 Kings chapter 22, starting in verse number 2, and we're calling this Cleaning House. Or we could title it, Who's in the House? JC, come on. Remember that. That's a shout out to Carmen. If you don't know who Carmen is, that's okay. Not Carmel, Carmen. Amen. 2 Kings chapter 22, verse number 2. We're gonna jump in there today. But before we do, I'm going to let you know that this entire message is going to be devoted to the thought of fasting. And in the next 2 weeks here, we're going to begin a fast that's going to go 10 days. And some may say, why 10 days instead of 21 at the beginning of the year? Well, number one, we didn't want you to have to fast on the Super Bowl. And the spiritual reason is that the number 10 has a lot of significance. And the third reason is that last year we did our fast and it was so successful. For the first time really ever, before this church, I was a youth pastor, and I felt alone whenever we would go into a church-wide fast, often, and not because people were just whatever, it's just because they were teenagers. And so I think I expected that same thing from the church, but last year, y'all shocked me. And, you know, we call the church-wide fast, and I wasn't fasting alone. There were people actually fasting with me, and seeing great breakthrough brought to their lives. And, you know, we were able to lay out kind of what a fast is and what it isn't. And today I want to lay that out a little bit, but I want to preach a little bit, if that's okay as well. The number 10 is very significant in many ways, besides, you know, missing the Super Bowl and being able to eat the wings at the wing party. And then leading right up to our conference. And then the very fact that last year, I think the most powerful part of our fast last year was the noontime prayer meetings that we held. And so we're going to be doing that again this year. And last year we went to like every location we could find. And sometimes the internet was good, sometimes it was bad. And sometimes we were glitching, and sometimes people were watching through the roof. So this year we have an office now. So we're going to be setting up in our office. We're going to be broadcasting some worship. We're going to have a different prayer leader each day and a different prayer focus. In fact, Super Bowl Sunday, which is next Sunday, come on. And so we're actually having a wing eating contest and a whole party after church. So we're going to have one service next Sunday. And we ain't going to fight Super Bowl. The first year I was here in L.A., I was like, man, we're going to fight the Super Bowl. You know, those Jesus people, I'm going to preach a word, you know. And guess what? Like, me and three people were there. And I realized that y'all just ain't that spiritual. Amen. Praise God. I realized that in America, you don't fight the Super Bowl. You join with them. Come on. So we're going to join with the Super Bowl, and we're going to make the Super Bowl holy. Amen. Praise God. And so we're gonna have one service, and then we're gonna have a wing, all you can eat wings, and then we're gonna have a wing eating competition. We're gonna watch the game on this screen for all those that want to watch the game on the screen. We're gonna have a private screen in the back for all those really serious people that don't like talking and don't like the pixels. And so it's just gonna be fun. Invite all your friends, your family, anyone from the outside world can come in. We don't have church detectors at the door, like. Beep, 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 beep. You know, too much sin. You know, no, we don't have that. So invite people in. People are looking for a place to watch the game. You would be surprised at who might come to this game and get saved. I have a friend that I brought to a Super Bowl party in high school, and he got saved. Wow. And it's crazy because he was the wildest person on our whole campus. I never thought of inviting him to church. I thought, well, if I'm invite him to anything, I'm invite him to the Super Bowl party. And so I invited him. My pastor did an altar call in the middle, and he got saved. And today I get texts from him all the time. His whole family are Christians now. He has kids and everything because he came to a Super Bowl party. Look. Invite your friends, your family. Hey, we're going to have all-you-can-eat wings. It's free. There is no cover charge. So that will happen after church. Don't even invite them to church. You come to church, you celebrate, and then invite them to the wing party, and I'll tell the gospel somewhere in there. Amen? Yeah. Amen. So next week, we're going to do that. It's going to be fun. It's going to be incredible. But right after that, we're going to go into a fast. So that's where we have an all-you-can-eat wings. You're going to gorge yourself on those wings. Don't do it too much. You might have a hard day, first day of fasting. And we're going to take 10 days. We're going to take 10 days together as a family. And just like he shocked me last year, I know that a lot of people are going to join with me in this. And I know for many of you, this will be the first fast you've ever done in your life. And because a lot of people are getting saved in this church for the first time or really getting themselves on fire. They went to church with their mom and dad, and then never really dived into the things of God. And so this might be your first adulting fast, right? The first fast you do as a grown adult, and you say, I am choosing this. No one's choosing this for me. And I want to tell you a couple things, practicals about a fast, before we dive in. And we're going to kind of do we're not going to call it a Daniel fast because Daniel fasted for 21 days, but we're going to do a Daniel type fast where we're eating the things that he ate. And then we're gonna not eat lunch together. That's kind of the plan that we're gonna have for 10 days. And during that lunchtime, my hope is that you could join us and pray together. We're gonna stream online, and then we're also gonna open up our offices if you want to come live. You're like, dude, I'd love the live stream, but I could come at lunch, and you can come worship with us. And then we're going to pray for our nation, our world. We're going to have a different scripture focus every single day. And at the Super Bowl party next week, the service, we're actually going to hand you out a booklet that has the scripture of the day. And then it's a journal, and so that you can journal what God is speaking to you. It's we're going to give that out at the next service. And so are you excited about that? I'm excited about that. And it's going to lead right up to our conference. Come on, I got a new Fear Not conference t-shirt on. Come on, it's pretty fire. Great job, David and the team. And I had a different shirt on, and Dave's like, I got a shirt for you. I'm like, yes, a new shirt. And so we're going to be selling these at conference, and I think they probably will sell out because they're so cool. And so anyways, conference is coming up. We want to sow into that with prayer. We want to believe for God to do all that he can do at conference. I don't know about you, but so next week, Super Bowl Sunday, and then the Sunday after that, we're calling it Conference Sunday. And so we're gonna have a whole Sunday that we dedicate to conference. So we're going to be giving away tickets. We're going to be helping people that don't have tickets yet to get tickets. Because really, it's not if we're going, it's how many people we're bringing, right? We're going to be bringing 10 each, I believe, right, into this conference. Because I really believe that if we carve out 3 days of our life for God to invade our lives, what could come of bad from that? What kind of investment is too big for that? And so I want to show you some videos. Maybe you're like, what is conference? You're like, is it like Comic-Con? Do I dress up in my favorite superhero? Hey, y'all can do that if you want. Just Bible heroes. No, because none of those are dressed like those superheroes. Amen. Praise God. We're going to explain what conference is. We're going to show you videos. I want to show you videos of past conferences. I really believe it's going to inspire you. I really believe it's going to open up vision in your life. I have a video I found of teenagers worshiping they worship for about an hour after the band left at like 11 p.m. at one of our conferences. They wouldn't stop singing because the presence of God was so thick in the room. And so we've seen people healed of all kinds of diseases. We've seen someone in a hospital bed that was on their way to conference that a rock slide fell on them, and they were out. They said there'd be a vegetable for the rest of their life. We were praying for that teenager, and they arose out of that hospital bed, and their family ended up at conference getting saved. I mean, we had incredible stories. So look, this is not just an event to us. This will be our Super Bowl, right? So next week we'll have the Super Bowl, and then the next week we'll talk about our Super Bowl. Amen? Amen. Can you bring it up in the monitors just a little bit, whoever's in charge? Thank you, guys. And so I want to tell you a few things about fasting, and hopefully I get to our scripture. Number one about fasting. Fasting is not about us, is not about God touching us. It's about us touching God. Okay, so look, fasting does not change God. It changes us. Okay, so, recently we saw the blood moon. Did anybody go look at that the other day? And then it was trippy reading the book of Acts and talks about the blood moon. And then I started watching videos and prophecies, and I'm like, wow, this is crazy. And, you know, the blood moon. And my son's like, why'd the moon turn to blood? And I'm trying to explain it. I'm trying to explain that the earth is moving and the moon is not, you know, and like, I don't even know how it all works. But at the end of the day, the moon didn't turn to blood. It's because a position changed. Right? There was a change of position in proximity to the sun, and it shifted our eyesight to something we've seen, and it shifted. And so when we fast, what happens is there's a change in position. God doesn't move, but we move. Okay? So we're moving. We're moving closer to God. God's not moving closer to us. Right? So when we fast, we are moving away from the things of this earth. Maybe it's chicken wings at first, but as you move away from chicken wings, you're also moving away from the community with people at a lunch table and your problems and your situation. And when you begin to move closer to God, the things in life that are weighing you down begin to look small in comparison to your great God. And so I don't know who needs that, but I need that, right? The Bible doesn't say at the woman in Matthew chapter 5, verse number 30, it says, once Jesus realized the power had gone out from him, he turned around to the crowd and he said, who touched my clothes? He doesn't ask, who did I touch? He said, who touched me? You see, God is walking through the crowd and no one has changed. God is coming through the crowd today and he's not wondering, who am I going to touch? He's wondering, who's going to touch me? Great. So fasting is us in the crowd, like the woman with the issue of blood, reaching out and saying, God, I know you got power to change my life, and I'm not waiting for you to touch me. I'm going to touch you. It's us moving ourselves, right, from a place of apathy, from a place of religious boredom. Look. If you do this thing called church, you're going to get bored. You're going to get religious, right? You forgot why you started it in the first place. But fasting has a way of shaking us out of religion and grabbing a hold of the hem of his garment again and saying, God, I'm demanding something out of your presence that would have passed me by had I not. Wow. Notice this woman would have just been passed by. She was not a part of the plan. But she changed the plan because of God's heart. She said, God, I'm coming after you. She pulled something into existence that wasn't for her time. Wow. This is the same thing that happened with Mary. Or not Mary, Jesus' mom. Jesus' mom is at a wedding, and she says, we're out of wine. They've run out of wine, so they don't receive embarrassment. Jesus, would you perform a miracle? Would you turn the water into wine? And Jesus says to his mom, woman... Now, never tell your mom that, especially if you're in a Hispanic household, you will die. Amen? That's what Chris told me, right? Your mom is kind of ghetto, you know what I'm saying? He says, woman, my time has not come. In other words, it's not time for me to do miracles. But her pull upon Jesus pulled a miracle into now that wasn't even a sign for that time. Look, if you begin to fast, you could pull miracles into this realm that weren't even a sign, that Jesus would have passed through the crowd, but now he begins to bring breakthrough in your life. I don't know who needs a breakthrough this year, who's desperate enough, who's tried enough other things that say, man, I'm going after the hem of your God. This is what fasting does. 10 days of breakthrough. Come on. Will you believe that with me?
How many of you guys think we need breakthrough in our city?
Number two, a fast is not getting ready to fight the devil. Like, if you're in a fight with the devil, the best thing to go into is not, you don't go into a fast because of that. You can, but let me tell you this. I have to say that because sometimes people get in a fast and it gets harder. A fast is you picking a fight with the devil. So Jesus is not tempted by the devil until he's in a fast. He's in the middle of a 40-day fast and the enemy starts. So I tell you that because you may get in the middle of the fast and feel more worn out, feel tired, feel like you're further from God, feel all these things. But I want to let you know, the moment you get in a fast, you are in a full-out fight with the enemy, and you're not fighting the enemy to win because God has already won. You are fighting to remind him of the victory God's already won. No, not to do that. You are fighting him to remind yourself of the victory that God has already won in your life, okay? So when you get in a fast, it may get more difficult. The enemy says, turn these stones into bread. You're thinking, well, that wasn't a temptation before I got in the fast, but now I'm hangry. It may be a temptation in the middle of the night. All of a sudden, you know, you never craved almonds at 1 a.m, but everyone's asleep, and you're thinking, man, I could really use some. Oh, you can eat almonds. Okay, let's say you may never have craved ramen in the middle of the night, but all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, you find yourself in Little Tokyo at that spot that stays open, and no one will see you. You're dressed in a hood and you're hiding. Look, the fight is going to come in the middle of this fast. So don't be surprised if you get more irritable or, you know, look, we're not going to be thrown off by that. These are all tests in the fast because the victory comes not in the fast, but after the fast. Jesus' authority was released fully. He stepped into his call after he was baptized. He went straight into a fast, but he stepped into walking out the call on his life after the fast. So I wonder what's going to happen after these 10 days of breakthrough. Come on. Come on, somebody. And the Bible is clear that fasting is not, so this is the third thing. The Bible is clear that fasting is not for the spiritually elite. Fasting is not just for all those five people that worship in front every week. And I'm kind of like, man, I don't know if I'm ready for that. Because the Bible doesn't say if you fast. Like it doesn't say if you pray, if you give. It says Matthew chapter 6 verse 2. So when you give. Verse number 5. So when you pray. Verse number 16. So when you fast. In other words, Jesus is not saying if you fast, it will be a great idea. He's saying, no, I know you're going to fast because it's a part of the Christian, part of the Christian life. And so just as giving to the Lord is a part of the Christian, we're not wondering, are we going to give? David's not up here trying to talk us into giving. He's just trying to remind us of who we are, right? We're not trying to get talked into worshiping or talked into praying. Just like I'm not here to talk you into fasting, I'm just here to remind you that when you fast, here's the ways to do it. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's go a couple more and then we'll get into our text if we have time. Let me see. Number four. Prayer and fasting go hand in hand. Okay? So fasting, like our world fasts, like, right? You go to the health food store and there's like a 10-day fast, a 15-day fast, a juice fast. And so fasting is by itself is not a spiritual thing. Fasting alone is maybe a good diet plan or, and we're not doing this just to lose weight, but you might lose weight in it, but we're not doing it to do that. You might get healthier by fasting, but we're not doing it to do that. Because we're partnering fasting of our body with the prayer in our spirit. And so fasting and prayer go hand in hand. I have to say that to you because for many years I fasted and I didn't see the powerful results that people talked about because I just didn't eat. And I said, oh, I'll pray when, and I'll pray later. And then later never came. Has that ever happened to you? You're like just starving yourself. And you're like, this is, maybe God will give me starving points. Like I'm just been seeing, and you've kind of turned it into something that it's not. And so I just want to encourage you that when dinner time comes, when lunchtime comes, to take those moments and guard them and go, okay, these moments are me with a meal with God. So if I'm going to eat with you, we're going to pray together while we eat. We're going to worship together while we eat. If we're going to eat a Daniel fast food, or we're going to actually eat nothing during lunch and just drink water or just drink juice, we're going to go to that noon prayer time. Or if you don't have your lunch at noon, then it's 1 o'clock, go back on Facebook. We're going to leave them up there, re-air it like it's happening live. And take that moment to get away from life and the pressures and the stress and get alone with God and get in tune with God. Amen? So we're not just going to not eat, right, what we used to eat. We're also going to pray, because prayer changes things. Sometimes it moves mountains. And maybe that mountain that needs to move is me, right? And so it might change my precept on something I thought about a certain way. It might change my judgment on something. And the last thing I want to tell you about prayer and fasting, we'll keep giving you more of these as we go, Instagram or whatever, but for sake of time, is this. We need fasting because anything that is alive long enough or lived in long enough will get dirty, messy, and out of order. Okay? So if you're going to live in this thing that's called the temple, you know that you're the temple of the living God, right? You know the Bible declares that you are his temple, and so we are his temple. And so because of that, we live in this temple. We live in this temple. Our spirit lives in this temple with God. God lives in the temple, and if you live in anything long enough, I have found that it will get out of order. It will get chaotic. And here's my question today. What if you cleaned the temple? What could you find? If it's a mess and you cleaned it, what could come about? So you know what we're doing this year? We're going to clean shop. We're going to clean house. Because anything lived long enough, even if you meant for good when you brought it in, even if it was a good trinket you thought would add some value to your house. Many of us are being buried alive in the junk we've allowed. Like, what is this? Like, whose shoe is this? This is how our first two kids were born. Hey, baby. No, just kidding. Amen. Praise God. I don't know. My mind is going weird places now. A microphone. I mean, I don't know if I can recover from that. I'm going to have to read the honor key. Just let me read that for a little while. You know, I mean, here we are in life. I mean, if you live in something long enough, my sister came over our house and hung out with us. And you know, she has five kids. My sister has five kids. I'm like, wow, five kids. And I'm like, every year I just want to give her a trophy for Christmas and a free massage. Amen. Praise God. And then she's thinking of having more kids. I'm like, what is wrong with you? Praise God. And not because kids aren't amazing, but they're also crazy. And our kids are crazy at least. And we love them most of the time. And we're praying that the Lord helps us. And so, you know, we live in a loft, me and my wife, and there's no walls in a loft, and no places to hide things. And so my sister, who has five kids, I mean, it's too expensive to live life with five kids. And so when they came, we know they can't grab a hotel with five kids. They need five rooms. And so we shamelessly just say, hey, why don't you stay with us? Did that just come out of my mouth? And they stayed with us for 5 days, seven of them, with the four of us at that time. And I felt like I was going mentally insane. And then one of the kids, the littlest one, got the flu. She's throwing up in the loft.
There's stuff in the loft. We have one bathroom in the loft. It seems that we all have to go to the bathroom at the same time all the time. And so we're dying. And by the end of that 5 days, it was the dirtiest. I didn't want to be in the loft. I didn't want to see the loft. I mean, it was so dirty. There were things. There was food. There was nuggets. There was nuggets having nuggets. I mean, it was just chaos. It was craziness. I didn't know what was happening to my life. And I realized that the longer you live in an environment and the more people that you share your life with, the messier it gets and the dirtier it tends to be. You didn't mean to get here. The plan wasn't to get here. You had good motives. You had a joyful heart when you thought of getting married. It was a good idea when you said, I do. But 6 months later, when the honeymoon wore off and someone was in your finances and someone was in your free time and someone was in your girl time and your shopping time and someone was looking at you, the things in you you didn't like in you, and someone was judging you, the real you that you never showed anyone, then it gets difficult. And then you think, this will be a good idea. Let's add kids on board because that will bring the fire back. And then life hits. You think, well, I'll move to L.A. and I'll make it big. And then you realize you ain't going to be living big in this city. You're going to be living real small in a tiny home unless you want roommates. And if you invite roommates in your house, then you invite a mess. Because you invite personalities and attitudes and things that you can't adjust to that are unlike you. And if you can't get along with your roommates, please don't get married. We're going to be in a lot of counseling sessions. And life lived in long enough for good motives gets messy. There's a story in the Bible in 2 Kings, and because of time, I don't have time to read it. Go back and read it later or come to second service. But the story goes like this. There's a young man who at 8 years old becomes king. He becomes king because his father was such a bad king that his own wise counsel stabbed him in the back and murdered him in their home so that he wouldn't continue in his evil ways. At 8 years old, this young man, my son's 5'8", probably won't be much more mature than he is now. At 8 years old, this young man becomes king. Not for a good reason, because his dad is now dead. He takes over the kingdom, but the Bible says that because of the people around him, he rules the kingdom godly, unlike his father. Wow. He's an orphan. He's alone. He's abandoned. And he's ruling the kingdom. The Bible says at 26 years old, anybody 26 in the house? Come on, raise your hand. 26, 26, close to 26. Come on. Yes, come on. Praise God. 26 in dog years. No, just God years. I don't know. 26 in my heart. Does that count? He's 26. He decides that it's time for him to clean house. The Bible says he tells the people in the temple, he says, all the offerings that have been coming in the temple, that's a mess because of my father. See, his father allowed temple idols, which turned into temple worship of other gods, which turned into temple prostitution. In the temple, the church, this kind of crazy stuff has been happening. At 26, the king goes, I'm taking charge of the temple. I'm taking charge of my home. He says, take all the money that's been given and let's use it to clean shop. They start cleaning the house in the temple. And as they're in the temple, they find a book. And they say, we found the book of the law, which is the first 5 books of the Bible. It had been lost for years in the mess. So I ask you this. I wonder what's been lost in the mess. God's not just calling us to get rid of the mess because he's like, you really need to clean up. Like, this is really embarrassing me.
No, he's trying to get us to get rid of the chaos, the noise, the extras, the offense, the hurt, the wounds, the fear, the anxiety, the oppression. He's saying, look, fasting gets rid of this stuff. It cleans it up. And the only reason why I want you to clean it up is not because I'm embarrassed of you. It's because I want you to find what's been missing, my word, in your life. And so the temple, they find the word, and the priest brings it to the king. And for the first time in his 26 years, he hears the word of God. He's known about the word of God. He's known about God. He sat in church and heard sermons. But for the first time, his ears are open because the temple's being cleaned. This is what happens in a fast. When you're in a fast, you start hearing things that you never heard out of John 3:16. You're like, oh my God, that was in there the whole time? I've heard 20 sermons on that, but I've never heard that. He hears the word for the first time. The Bible says he rips his robes. It doesn't tell us what was read. So I'm like, what was read? I mean, this king is just, he's all good. And something is read to him from this book that has been lost for 400 years. 400 years is a long time. Did you know we only became the United States 243 years ago? Think about life 400 years ago. No microwaves, no TV, no phones, no internet. If we were to talk to someone 400 years ago, there's going to be this thing called the internet. They would look at us like we're crazy. 400 years before this moment, this word had been lost for 400 years. So he reached him. So I started looking through the Bible, and I wanted to see what was read. And I believe to have found what was read over this king. Look at this. 1 Kings chapter 13, verse number 1. At the Lord's command, a man of God came from Judah to Bethel. Verse number 2. Then the Lord's command, he shouted, O altar. This is 400 years before this king ever was born. O altar, this is what the Lord says. A child named Josiah, that's the king's name, will be born into the dynasty of David. On you, altar, he will sacrifice the priest from pagan shrines who have come here to burn incense, and human bones will be burned on you. 400 years before he's ever born, he hears read over him his name, that he will be a part of something that God had a plan of the whole. He ends up being king because he thought because of pain. But God reminds him, no. Nothing happens on accident. I allowed you to be in the family I allowed you to be in for the moment I allowed you. I don't miss things. I don't mess things. And a word comes from this cleansing that shifts his whole life. Before that, he was an orphan, alone, depressed, and without a father. But after he hears that word, he realizes he has a father in Father God who has chosen him. 400 years before he was born. What if I could take you into a library and I can read you a book that was written 400 years before you were born? What if one of the first pilgrims would have written? A guy named Kevin will show up to America. And he will renew it. He will change it. He will transform it. What if 400 years ago someone had written about you? Well, let's try 2,000. Your name's in here. But you will never find your name in here unless the temple begins to get clean. You see, at my house, well, when we used to have a house, now we have a loft, so it doesn't work. There's no rooms in a loft. We just got one room. So if you come over our house unannounced, just know we're not going to answer the door for about 30 minutes because we have to clean. But in my house, whenever we'd have people over and they would come over unannounced, what do we do? Hey, I'll be right there. Just getting ready. Just hold on one sec. Wasn't dressed. Didn't know you're coming over. Come on, honey. Get everything. Everything. Come on. Put it in that room. Come on. Everything we got to get it in there. Come on. Hurry up. Get it all in there. Hurry. Cause they're coming. They're coming over. Come on. Just get it. Hurry. Someone help me. Come on. Someone help me get all this crap out of here. Come on. Kids. I know you're having fun right now, but we can't leave the house a mess. Why? Cause people are coming over. And if they come over and see our mess, they're going to think we're crazy. So we just put this in here.
Hopefully your house doesn't do that.
So we opened the door. Hi. Great you came over. Can you do this every day? I love when you come out without telling me you're coming. Come on in. Come on, don't. Hey, look over there. Look at that. This is how we live our life in church. That's how we live our life with God. Hey, God, coming over unannounced. Huh? Keep showing up. There you are. A little embarrassed about this. Just don't look and you won't see it. I'm going to be like Adam. I'm going to hide amongst the trees. I'm going to throw this in there. Just get it out of here because, you know, if God sees it, he's going to be embarrassed of me. I don't want him to not feel welcome in my house. And so we all, if we lived in our life long enough, we've built up enough stuff. And so we hide those things behind some door in our house and we say, God, come in, but don't come in all the way. Come, God, I'll go to church, I'll be a part, but I don't know if I really want to step into that level. Because if I do, I may have to open the junk room. Something in there may come out. People may know that I'm a hoarder. You know, when you watch this hoarder show, it's unique because they have to go through like counseling as they clean their house. Because the things in their house have become their identity. Literally, the guys over there just weeping. And I'm like, they just threw away a plastic microphone. It's a Dollar Tree item. Another lady, she was crying because they had a wrapper from her favorite candy bar. They threw it away and she began crying uncontrollably. How silly does that sound? Yet, in our lives, we're hanging on to that wrapping paper of hurt. We're hanging on to that ribbon of their offense. And we put it on the mantle like it's a trophy. Like it's actually a part. Please don't take this, God. This is a part. This hurt is a part of me. I was hurt in church. And for the rest of my life, people are going to know about it. Come on, look, it's not to say it didn't happen. I'm not saying it's not trash. I'm just saying, why keep living with that abuse from when you were five? Why keep living for when someone brought the dump truck over and dumped it on your life? No, you are the temple of the living God. Come on, this year we're going to fast, we're going to pray, and we're going to clean out the temple. We're going to say, you know, God, I invite you in. I don't know what to do with all this. I'm actually a little overwhelmed because I've been stuffing things in this closet for years. There might be dead things in this closet, things that you covered in the blood that I buried in my house. And God, I need your help. I need your help to clean this out. I need to touch you. I need you, Holy Spirit, to come in. I need every angle, every area, every nook, every cranny. I need you to wipe off the dust of yesterday. I need you to clean this place out. I need you to clean the house. Not because you're embarrassed of my mess, because you want to redecorate. There are things you put in here that I've missed. Like, I think sometimes we think, oh man, I'm going to clean this out because God's really mad at me. No. He's just trying to show you what he's given you. He's trying to show you the couch he bought you that you can't see because offense and hurt and wounds and fear has been sitting on it and covering it. God's like, I've given you a bed that you can't sleep in. I've given you a kitchen you can't cook in. For 10 days, we're going to reset ourselves. For 10 days, we're going to say, God, come on, give God 10 days. Give God 10 days to come in and say, God, come in. Holy Spirit, come in. Cleaner, come in. Come on, this is what this series is about. Fear not. Come on, fear not. We've been living this way long enough. We've been living this way long enough. And the enemy keeps going, yep, can't really invite anyone over, huh? Yep, can't really go deeper in relationship. I know you were born for relationship. I know you're dying without it. But if you really let someone in, they'd know what you looked at last night. They know what you thought about yesterday. They know you were molested when you were five. And they would look at you different. They would think about you different. But the Holy Spirit says, no. No, come on, let's clean this house. Come on, these are not trophies. These are not what I called you to. Come on, we're going to make room for your new family. We're going to make room for your friends. We're going to clean this house.
not because you're dirty, but because life has brought a whole bunch of stuff into your house. Come on, this ain't no reality show. This is our life. It's time to discover what was written about us before words appeared in this world. God had a plan for us before our mom had a plan for us, our dad. And once God begins to clean this, I believe that during the fast, He's going to begin to show you stuff and reveal to you stuff that you have never seen before in your life. And it's going to shift you. After the king received that word, he went out and became that word. He ripped down the altars. He cleaned out the temple. People were like, man, he was bent on something. Something had hit him. Yep, that's right. Something had hit him. He had been given new courage, new passion, new fire, new zeal, new comfort, new love. And God wants to give you that today. Come on, would you stand up to your feet all over this room? You know, the first call is we're just going to do this. You know, we're going to say, man, maybe you're in this room. You say, man, I don't know how to fast. I don't really know all there is to fasting. I'd love to learn more. But I believe this would be something for me. I want you just to grab hands across this room. You say, man, I believe this is something for me. I believe I need to clean up shop. I believe there are things in my life that maybe need to get out of my life. And I believe that God wants to reveal to me some new things this year. Come on, if that's you, I want you to squeeze your neighbor's hand and say, you know what? Maybe I don't know how to fast. Maybe I've never fasted, but you know what? I'm willing to take an adventure with God. I want you to squeeze your neighbor's hand in this room. Say, that's me. And if your neighbor squeezed your hand, I want you to squeeze it back. Let him know, hey, I got you, man. I got you. You know what? Let's be accountability. Let's be accountability. When the day after Super Bowl, we're going to do a 10-day thing together. And we're gonna fast and we're going to pray. And we're going to believe for life change to happen in our life. Come on, if your neighbor squeezed your hand, you squeeze it. I want you to begin to pray for them. Right now, say, Jesus, I pray for strength. I pray for newness. I pray for cleansing. I pray for revelation. And I pray for power in their life. God, I pray that just like the woman that grabbed the hem of your garment, as we together grab the hem of your garment, power would go out from you and into our lives. And that power would change us. God, I ask that my faith would be made whole. And Lord, I believe that in this fast, you have things to show me. You have things you want to do in this temple. And God, I give you freedom today to do that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.